welcome to Jay Coletti's Racket Reviews. My name is Jay Coletti, and I will be your hostess. Here on Racket Reviews, we are dedicated to learning about all things organized crime, and I'm really looking forward to another individual study with you today, focused on outfit hitman Felix Alderisio. Alderisio's life was a roller coaster of success and failure. He would rise to the very top of outfit leadership, but then at the end of his life, descend into near obscurity. If you're enjoying the channel and would like to become a Racket Reviews patron, please head on over to the Patreon account and join the Coletti family. Now, without further ado, we have much to discuss, so let's get right to it. Felix Antonio Alderisio was born on April 26, 1912 in Yonkers, New York, to Italian immigrant parents Dominic and Pauline Alderisio. He was the second of the couple's four children. By the Prohibition era, the family had moved to Chicago. Alderisio would begin working in crime with the teenage street crew, the 42 Gang, named after Alibaba and the 40 Thieves, founded in 1925. With this crew, Alderisio would meet the men who would help make his career: Sam Giancana, Sam Battaglia, Sam DiStefano, Fiore Buccieri, William Dadano, Charles Nicoletti, and others. With the 42 Gang, Alderisio would be involved in theft, holdups, which often included murder, car theft, and car stripping, rackets in which he would continue throughout his criminal career. And Alderisio was not passive in his desire to climb the criminal ranks. As a juvenile, he would spend his time waiting outside of Al Capone's headquarters, the Lexington Hotel, in hopes to find work as an outfit messenger. For his trouble, he would be arrested for vagrancy. While Sam Giancana was the first of the 42 Gang to be welcomed into the ranks of the Chicago outfit, Alderisio was not far behind. All while Felix Alderisio was attempting to join the Mafia family, his biological family also included criminals. His maternal cousin, Louis Fratto, who would later, through marriage, cause Alderisio to be related to William Dadano, had been involved in crime for quite some time in the Chicago area. Fratto, who was working with the Fiore crime family out of Iowa, a family which would ultimately serve as Capone's inn in the city of Des Moines, Iowa, made their living during the Prohibition era strong-arming speakeasies to pay them protection fees. Fratto would have worked his way up to secretary and treasurer of the Wardrobe Check Washroom Attendant and Doorman's Union by 1933. Around December of that year, Fratto would recruit not only his cousin Alderisio, but also his childhood friends Sam Battaglia and Marshall Caifano for enforcement work. Later, Fratto and Alderisio would head to Milwaukee, Wisconsin for work in gambling, where they would meet and befriend John Eliotto, who would go on to be the boss of the Milwaukee crime family and father-in-law to Frank Balestrieri, perhaps the most infamous Milwaukee boss who would lead the Milwaukee family from 1961 to 1993. And it's in Milwaukee where we get Felix Alderisio's Mafia nickname. During his time in Milwaukee, he would also try his hand at boxing, where apparently the name Felix wasn't tough enough, so he went by Phil, or Milwaukee Phil, in the ring, and the name stuck. In 1934, Fratto and Alderisio would be arrested on gambling charges. To escape the charges, Fratto fled to Des Moines, Iowa, and Alderisio headed back to Chicago. At this point, Alderisio had gained a reputation for brutality through his enforcement work with his cousin, and would be welcomed into the crew run by Sam Giancana under Tony Accardo, who was under Paul Rico's authority, and Rico was either the boss of the outfit or the underboss to Frank Nitti. This was a transitional and difficult time for the outfit. Not only were they losing their charismatic leader Al Capone to tax evasion charges, and later syphilis, but the question of leadership amidst the controversy and debate around Nitti or Rico created a palpable tension within the ranks. But this tension didn't stop Alderisio's rise, as he would find work with a man whose position was never in doubt, and that was Jake Guzik. Guzik, the outfit's financial leader and political fixer, had plenty of work for an ambitious mobster like Alderisio. Milwaukee Phil found impactful work as Guzik's bagman, or payoff delivery man, for Chicago's politicians, police officials, and judges. And of course, while work with the nonviolent Guzik did raise Alderisio's station, it was not his bread and butter. Alderisio worked closely with Charles Nicoletti as hitman and muscle for Sam Giancana, a man known for violence himself. Throughout the next several years, Alderisio would be suspected of 14 mob murders. Alderisio was officially made in the Chicago outfit in 1956, shortly after the induction of Dadano, and during the time that Sam Giancana was the boss of Las Vegas and soon to be acting boss of the entire outfit. Alderisio was sponsored, or recommended for being made, by Marshall Caifano and Sam Battaglia. His main area of influence would be in Melrose Park, beneath the direction of Sam Battaglia. Alderisio's ability to commit bold murders are what sealed the deal for the outfit to make him an official member. And this sponsorship of Alderisio would pay off almost immediately, as he became one of the main players in the international heroin trade. Apparently, Alderisio really enjoyed travel, both recreationally and for business, and it would seem did not stop talking about it. As caught on federal wiretape, he had enraged Sam Giancana with his constant commentary on the ruins of Europe. Giancana said, quote, "I got coppers coming out of my eyeballs, and you keep sitting there telling me about ruins." Continuing on the discussion of Alderisio's personal life, there's not much known known about his wife Molly, and the couple does not appear to have had any children. What we do know is that Alderisio, Battaglia, and their wives carpooled together for the wedding of Tony Accardo's daughter on April 27th, 1961. In business, Alderisio was involved in more than just drugs. Throughout his career, he would be arrested more than 36 times on charges varying from counterfeiting to loan sharking to extortion to racketeering to gambling and to, of course, murder. Alderisio ran a team of cat burglars as well, and apparently let them practice on his own neighbors. I bet that did wonders for the property value. In April of 1961, it was found that Alderisio was connected to the disappearance of 300 vehicles that had gone missing on March 5th and 6th of 1961 from the Sterling Harris auto lot in connection to the infamous loan shark and Alderisio partner, Leo Rugendorf. This mostly came out of the testimony from an employee at Sterling Harris, who claims that he had seen Alderisio on the premises prior to March 4th. On May 2nd, 1962, CPD officers responded to a radio call about suspicious activity regarding a parked 1962 four-door Ford sedan. When they arrived on the scene, they found Felix Alderisio and his pal and fellow hitman, Charles Nicoletti, sitting in a vehicle outfitted with secret switches for the brake and taillights and a switch that activated a secret gun compartment. This hitmobile was apparently Alderisio's design. When asked what they were doing, they explained that they were waiting for a friend. In 1959, Ruby Colwood and Willie Alderman would take out a loan from Sam Giancana to invest in an oil lease through businessman Robert Sunshine. This investment was around $100,000, and Sunshine, it would appear, was a schemer who swindled Colwood and Alderman, and subsequently Sam Giancana, out of their cash investment. The request for a return of the money was sometimes given back in part by Sunshine to keep the men off his back, or promised to be returned in monthly payments. Inevitably, the monthly payments would stop, causing Collard and Alderman to furiously telephone Sunshine and threaten to send a lawyer, or Chicago lawyer, to him to get the money back. It turns out that the Chicago lawyer was lacking in legal credentials and happened to be Felix Alderisio. According to Sunshine's testimony, Alderisio had threatened to kill him in Denver, Colorado on July 6, 1961. From Sunshine's residence, Alderisio telephoned Collard at the Concord Hotel in Monticello, New York, to ask him what he wanted to be done with Sunshine. Collard instructed Alderisio to spare Sunshine this time, but made it clear that there would not be a next time. Well, Sunshine didn't cough up the money, but he did run straight to the authorities. When Collett and Alderman called for Alderisio to be a witness on their behalf, Alderisio refused. He moved for a protective order to prevent Collett and Alderman from calling him as a witness, attaching to his motion an affidavit in which he swore that his July 6, 1961 visit to Sunshine was related to a business matter Alderisio had, which had nothing to do with Collett and Alderman. He refused to testify if called by Collett and Alderman, but would otherwise plead the Fifth Amendment in relation to that July 6th, 1961 visit to Sunshine. After lengthy testimonies and multiple court dates, it was pieced together that the loan had originated from Sam Giancana. Because of this, Alderisio was uncooperative and reluctant to testify, as he did not want to have Giancana's name added to the mix in this criminal trial. Due to his reluctancy, Alderisio was convicted and sentenced to 4.5 years in prison, plus a $7,500 fine in 1965. He would file for an acquittal multiple times, but they were all denied. Alderisio continued spending time in and out of court and jail fighting this charge throughout the remainder of the decade. During the 1962 McClellan hearings, also known as the Valachi hearings, Alderisio was called to testify, but would plead the Fifth 23 times throughout the questioning. During this time, he was identified as an outfit underboss beneath Sam Giancana. Also, according to later court testimony, it would seem that Alderisio had a hand in the May of 1962 Eminem murders as well, which we covered in more detail last week. Okay, time to get into some mafia politics. In 1964, Sam Giancana was being removed from his position as acting boss of the outfit. He was drawing way too much attention to their operation, and this was made publicly official in 1965 when Giancana was put away for a year for contempt of court. According to the Chicago Tribune, a meeting was held at the home of Tony Accardo on January 16, 1964, to vote on the removal of Giancana from outfit leadership. The voters included Sam Battaglia, William Dadano, Rudolph Fratto, Frank Fratto, Albert Frabotta, and Felix Alderisio. As a quick fun fact, all of these men were related by either blood or marriage. Giancana was voted out. There were two factions in light of Giancana's removal: those who wanted Sam Battaglia from Melrose Park to take over, and those who would prefer Fiore Buccieri, the West Side loan shark who had frequently dealt with Giancana's affairs while he was away in the past. Both men had been 42 gang members with Giancana. Buccieri would have been favored to take on the role of acting boss from Giancana had he not suffered a recent heart attack. Sam Battaglia was given leadership of a house divided in 1966. It made things worse when Giancana was released from jail, and instead of working to keep the family together, he had headed straight to Mexico. Battaglia was boss, but he was extremely unpopular. He was not terribly focused on the outfit's operations, as he was in the midst of dealing with his own legal problems that would result in his imprisonment just a year into his time as boss. After this, there is still debate about what exactly happened next. This was a very fuzzy and murky time for the Chicago outfit, and there were tons of leadership changes throughout this era. Either Jackie Cerrone or Felix Alderisio took over as boss after Battaglia was sent away. It seems to me that Alderisio took over from 1967 to 1971, but other reports maintain that Cerrone took over from 67 to 69, with Alderisio coming in from 69, the year his father passed away, to 1971. In any case, he was also very unpopular, and just like his predecessor, would find himself behind bars before there was too much influence he could really exact on the outfit. In July of 1969, federal authorities seized Alderisio for conspiracy to defraud the bank. This charge of conspiracy to defraud the bank was the conclusion of a four-year FBI investigation that included 21 counts of extortion and conspiracy. Apparently, this had taken place around the time of the 1965 oil lease, which he was still fighting. He was also indicted for establishing fake and insufficient collateral for home improvement loans. He was taken into custody on Sunday, July 28th of 1969, from his home in Riverside, Illinois. 20 federal agents had surrounded the home for the arrest, and the bond was set at $100,000. On March 31st, 1970, the year that his mother died, Alderisio was in the midst of trying to appeal the guilty verdict by claiming that the convicting information had been obtained by means of illegal law enforcement recording, specifically of his businesses, Solano's Tailor Shop, the Armory Lounge, and more specifically, the Gaylor Mercantile Company from March to November of 1963, and the First National Mortgage Company between October 2nd of 1964 and April 7th of 1965. Despite his best efforts to appeal, the court held their guilty verdict and he remained in prison. On September 25th, 1971, Felix Alderisio died in federal prison in Marion, Illinois, of natural causes. His funeral was attended by several outfit members, including Tony Accardo. Felix Antonio Alderisio was buried at Queen of Heaven Cemetery in Hillside, Illinois. I hope you've enjoyed this episode of Racket Reviews, stepping through the murky waters of one of the outfit's top hitmen, Felix Alderisio. I'll admit to you openly that Alderisio had one of the more convoluted timelines that we've covered in this channel, due in no small part to his propensity to move around all the time. Make sure to let me know in the comment section below or on Facebook and Twitter what you think about Alderisio. I know he was a very popular recommendation. Also, don't forget to utilize the comment section and social media to let me know who you would like to see covered next. I always love hearing from you, and I'm always happy to investigate. Make sure to like, subscribe, and click notifications to get more Mafia content sent directly to your sub box. Ciao.